next speaker is Mayo Fuster Morel. She is a well-known scholar from the Open University of Barcelona, UOC. We have collaborated in the past and, around social movements and especially on the 11 May movement in Spain and the transformation that provoked in different areas of the Spanish society from the year 2011 onward. But today, Mayo will be presenting a different piece of research. She's a well-known scholar, leading one of the groups more interesting production in Spain. I think it's the Digital Common, or no, Dimon group. Other members of this group participate in this conference also. And she is member or has been member and co-founder of multiple initiatives around the digital commons. And the presentation of today have the title of Collaborative Policies for Collaborative Economy. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Benjamin, for the presentation. And good morning, everyone. The first thing I want to say is that I am very happy to be here. I passed my childhood holidays in Bilbao, so coming here bring me with a holidays spirit. I'm going to present, I prepare a presentation about sharing society, particularly regarding the economical and political sides. The presentation I'm going to make is fruit of the work of a whole team, Demons, which actually I am here, but also Ricard Spelt and Sara Moreira, which are just there, also are part of the team and will present in other sessions. Demons is an action research group. We are going to reflect about collaborative economy, collaborative policy, but actually it can be collaborative research too. And at least we are inspired by this idea, and in Demons, as an action research group, we try to incorporate the results of our research on collaborative production into how research is organized. I am extremely happy to present after David Bollier, which is a colleague we have been collaborating for the past 15 years. Because actually our mission is fostering socioeconomic innovation through research and action for a common-oriented society. I think after the presentation of David, you can understand what commons-oriented society refer to. The presentation is organized in two sides. A first side, which is looking more into the economical part regarding an introduction of what a platform or platform collaborative economy means. In a second part, I will focus into the political side and the public policy and platform economy. I'm going to make a lot of references about the case of Barcelona because it's the case we have been researching more because we are also there, but actually someone once say that Catalonia is the best country for the social economy, which because the best country is one of the worldwide places where social economy and cooperativism has developed. And so actually reflecting into Barcelona, it has also to do with reflecting into a city, which is one of the cities with more growing of the ecosystem of collaborative mode of doing economy and policy is happening. So platform economy, sometimes referred as collaborative economy, or it has many terms, refer to a mode of consumption, exchange of production of goods and services of any kind between distributed group of people, a community of people which is not necessarily in the same place, mediated by a digital platform. So the element that is, there is a digital platform that is mediating this mode of production is the key dimension. But there are very, very different type of platforms economy, and they have and there is actually a confusion about the different types and how far we can characterize a digital platform as a collaborative one. It's not the same Wikipedia or Goteo, a crowdsourcing platform, than Airbnb and Uber, but nevertheless both typologies can be characterized as platform economy, and actually they share common characteristics. This mode of production supported by digital platforms emerged through the with the adoption of the new technologies and has been impacting industries over the decades. The first industry in which this mode of economic production emerged, or the classic one, is the software industry, with the free and open source software projects like Linux. And actually, it has become the dominant and the hegemonic mode, in the sense of there are areas of software in which the modality of production, being a more collaborative oriented one, is the dominant. It has also impacted the cinema industry with the new modes of distribution, music industry. Wikipedia in 2001 was also a very successful example, and an ambit, the encyclopedia, that has been totally disrupted by this mode of production. Scientific production through the incorporation of open access, tourism, vacational rental, now with the impact of cases like Airbnb and taxi services and mobility with Uber and Cabify. So what I am trying to refer here is that this mode of production supported by digital platforms and involving some kind of collaboration with a community of people spread, it's very ubiquitous. It can emerge in many areas of activities and it's disrupting industries. The type of modality, more really collaborative, like the case of Wikipedia or the open source project, in contrast to the more extractionist one like Uber or Airbnb, the type of modality that prevail in an industry might change, but the element that the element of the disruptive impact of digital platform production or the platformization of industry is going to happen almost in any ambit. Here, this visualization is the result of an analysis of a European project we did 2 years ago on the project P2B Value, which it was based on making a sample of 300 cases at in Europe. And we analyzed which are the areas of activities. And we identified 32 areas of activities in which actually we can identify this mode of production based in digital platforms. And the distribution of the squares have to do with which are the areas which are more present, this modality of production. And the biggest one, the brown one, is the free and open source software projects, because actually, is the ambit which first emerged. And particularly at the beginning, the platform modality of production was very much it was more present in the ambits of production of immaterial things. But over time, we have seen the emergence of also this modality of productions in ambits that also involve fabrication of things. In the presentation, David has explained about the WikiCard, the Fab Labs, and all these, also the open source ecology projects, that is the collaborative production through open design of agriculture machinery, no? So this, again, disruption, what's happening? So, no? Someone wants to disrupt the talk? Again, how it's progressing into also the production of material things or the services, in the sense of the case of caring communities, that they, through digital platforms, they organize the caring of kids between communities of fathers or mothers, or the agriculture consumption cooperatives that Ricard Espel will present later together with Sara Mereira, Moreira, regarding the organization through digital platforms and the facilitation of coming together of cooperatives for the consumption of agriculture products based on proximity. So again, this is a way to say that a platform economy is not like a sector, no? It's a mode of production that is expanding and arriving to almost any kind of ambit of activity. But there is not only this expansion through areas of activity, but there is also the differentiation between actual models of platform economy. And here, at the beginning, when I was referring to Wikipedia and Goteo, is different, even if it's different than what Uber and Airbnb are, even if they both are based on platform production. Over time, it has become its time more necessary to define criteria of typification of the different modalities of platform economy. And in order to embrace this necessity of defining which elements differentiate the different type of what differentiates something like Wikipedia from Uber, and what actually can be characterized as truly collaborative or as sharing from something that might be based on a platform but might have collaborative dimensions but cannot be characterized as fully collaborative. From this necessity of differentiating model, we have in Demons, particularly with Ricard Espel, I have been developing this framework of understanding of collaborative qualities, democratic qualities, commons qualities, no, that help us to differentiate between digital platforms. And there are mainly three dimensions. We have applied these three dimensions of the star of qualities into a sample of 100 cases, and this allow us to emerge modes of platforms. Will it be possible to have a microphone so I can come here, if it's possible? So, thank you. So, if we apply the three dimensions of the start, it emerges mainly three modalities of platforms, digital platforms. The first dimension, which allow us to differentiate between platforms, has to do with the governance. How decision making is being taken, which is the, thank you very much. Thank you, it's working. So the first one, referring to the governance of the platform, which is the legal form, which is the decision making, and which is very connected to the economic model. The second dimension, the green one, has to do with which are the technological policies and which is the knowledge and data policies, which is platform economy happening in the digital sphere. And in this sphere, how technology is being set up and how knowledge is being managed and the conditions of access of it has tremendous implication for power dynamics and for the distribution of the governance between the community which is involved in the production. And finally, the last dimension have to do with the impact of value creation, in terms of value creation, how far these platforms have an impact covering a need, economic impact, creating community, creating a resource that is being used, and they are also socially responsible towards the externality this generate. This framework, I'm not going to expand it, but this framework came from confluence in three main theoretical perspectives
of the Commons theory, actually. The first one have come from the Ostrom School of the Commons, referring to the governance, the modality of governance of the process as the of the democratic quality that refers to a process of collective production. The second one came more from the Cyber scholars, like Benkler, Lessig, Rose, referring that the equality of a process have to do with the conditions of access and the conditions of intervening without requiring the permission of others. And the last one came more from the social economy tradition about being socially responsible and they have impact beyond economical perspective of value, but also social value. So if we apply these different criteria into the digital platforms, if emerge three modalities. So regarding the governance, the third modality, which actually was the first one to appear, I did the thesis in 10 years ago about the evolution in history of the modalities and actually the Open Commons modality of governing the collaborative production through digital spheres were the first one in to appear. Here we have the case of Wikipedia or Goteo, a crowdfunding platforms. And here we have foundations which somehow have a system of representing the community which is involved into the control of the infrastructure of production or the means of production. This is the case, for example, of Wikipedia, in which Wikipedians have a very complex system of decision making by which they can apply consensus decision making around the definition of the articles, but then they also choose the administrators, or they annually celebrate elections for deciding who are going to represent the community into the board of the foundation, which is the owner of all the infrastructure. No? So here we have a form of decision making in which somehow the community which is involved can be represented. And this is very different kind of modality. Also regarding how it's been funded and how far the community has decision making around the distribution of the benefits around it, than the case of Unicorn, of Airbnb and Uber, in which the community of people who is interacting or using the platform can actually have a very, well, doesn't have a role, neither as a, if you could say, as a form of work representation as part of Uber or representation of the hosters as part of Airbnb. This very close kind of governance. They are basically multinational corporations which they provide the platform, but they don't involve the users of the platform in the structure of decision making, neither in the distribution of the decision making or distribution of the benefits or the decision making about the funding, which is mainly venture capital funding that came to the platform. And there is a third modality which is more recent that has been a contra reaction into this. This more it's called platform cooperativism. Later on, my colleague Stacco will present more in detail. Platform cooperativism, open cooperativism, it has different terminology, which refers to the case in which the platform is being owned by a cooperative, and all the people or the people who is using the platform become a member of the cooperative, and through the cooperative they can involve intervene in the decision making. This is what differentiated three modalities regarding the governance and the economical model. Regarding the technological and knowledge policy, Open Commons tend to be based on a collective and public ownership of the infrastructure, referring that is based on free and open source software projects and open data. This is very different from Airbnb and Uber that are based on proprietary software and restricted copyright. Cooperative platforms, they depend on the case, not all of them embrace this element of open knowledge. But this is, again has, as I say previously, tremendous implication for power distribution, because I'm going to just give an example, through the case of Wikipedia. In Wikipedia at the beginning, Wikipedia was a company. And the owner of this company wanted to incorporate advertising for funding the project. And the community of people, the Spanish community of people who were Spanish, not the people in Spanish community of Wikipedia, was not, didn't agree with this decision of incorporating advertisement or this risk of possibility. So they say, well, because the Wikipedia is based on free and open source software, and the license of the content allow us to replicate them, they actually did that. This is called forking. So when it's based on open source and free licenses, you can take the content and go somewhere else and you get independent from the infrastructure provider, in this case of, at that time, the owner of the company owning the Wikipedia. So this forced the founder of Wikipedia to actually retreat his decision of incorporating advertisement and created the foundation in order to preserve the project, no? So this is an example of becoming more democratic in order to assure the continuation of a project that actually has become a very successful one, no? And this element of being able to have power to get independent from the infrastructure is absolutely not possible in the case of this modality, no? Last one, referring to the value creation from a broader perspective of value and the social responsibility. Here it's very difficult to actually have data in the sense of it's extremely difficult and there is a lot of debate about how to you can measure inclusiveness or you can measure in terms of social responsibility or you can measure environmental impact, no, of these kind of platforms. But in the analysis that we have been applying, it emerged that these modalities, both the open commons and the platform cooperatives, tend to generate economic value, but also social value, and tend to be more responsible in terms of environmental impact through the incorporating of dynamics of circular economy, of reuse. But then they tend to not perform well in terms of inclusion, referring to gender inclusion. Even the modality of open commons tend to be very exclusionary in the sense of the open modality of collaboration, even if might provide be more participative in certain modes, tend to be reinforce inequality in terms of gender. To give an example, the free and open source software projects have 1.5% of women developers, while the proprietary modality of software have 30% of women. So here you have a case in which a more hierarchical, organized, closed modality of production perform better in terms of inclusion of women. No? So here it's a problem, an ambit to improve. Nevertheless, in terms of gender, it's very, it's also known the problems of the discrimination, racial discrimination, gender discrimination of the algorithm of Airbnb or Uber, or the, it sounds anecdotic, but the reason why the CEO of Uber retreat from his position was based also on scandals of gender abuse in the company. So it's an area which it's problematic actually in all of the modalities. Coming to the case of Barcelona to situate the mode of production, I think it's very important to, when thinking about platform economy, not to think only in terms of which are the platforms and case-based analysis, which is most of the literature on platform economy is based on case-based, one just analyzing one case or doing some case comparison, but actually think about the ecosystem dynamic. In the case of Barcelona, we identify in this directory of the peer-to-peer value 1,000 projects being present, and 50 of them were not actually platforms themselves. They are connected to the so we identified that the ecosystem of collaboration and sharing in Barcelona has a lot of resources or groups that are not platforms themselves, but are actually groups that provide like networks or creative commons group, they provide like services for the platforms to happen. And it's very important that this generating an ecosystem of exchange between the platform in order to actually to have a thread and growing ambit in the city. We analyzed a set of cases in Barcelona and applied the START, this set of cases. This is the application of the three dimensions into 10 cases of Barcelona to visualize. And green means that they perform well, the indicators regarding this dimension. And red means that they didn't perform well, and orange means that they might be in between. So what I want to transmit into this visualization, which was somehow also present in my previous explanation of the previous table, is that any of the 10 cases, even if these 10 cases that we select, they tend to be the more collaborative side and open commons or platform cooperativist modality, any of them perform all the dimensions. So we here, there is any case that actually have all the qualities, collaborative qualities or democratic qualities that we define, but some of them might be very good in certain qualities and others in other qualities. The qualities that are more present are the governance and the economic ones. The ones who tend to be more in red, let's say, is the technological and open knowledge type of dimensions, no? And this is also to prevent to have a kind of a purist perspective or a very or approach to this field in a very restrict mode, because it's a field that is changing a lot and has a lot of plurality in its composition. This is the concrete indicators that we use to each of the dimensions. We also analyzed in the sample of 100 cases, we analyzed if actually the different dimensions of democratic quality relate to each other. And we find that actually there is not a relation between the dimensions and the type of collaboration or the ambit, but actually the projects that tend to be based in open software, they also tend to have a open data and open license policy. This somehow is something you can expect. The cases who tend to be have a more democratic governance tend to be also based in an economic modality of sustainability and investment that also tend to be more collaborative, so they go together. And there is a tendency that the projects that are more democratic in terms of governance and economic modality, they tend to use also a type of software and knowledge that is more open and collaborative. But something we didn't expect to find and something to reflect upon is that there is not a relation of these dimensions with the social responsibility and impact. As I was saying in the previous two tables, the question of what actually the impact is and the social responsibility is, it can be very problematic even in the cases that might try to be more democratic in terms of the governance or their dimensions, no? This might change depending on the type of a specific ambit of area of economic activity, but overall, the sample, this is what emerged. Now coming to this political side of the phenomenon and the public policy dimension of the platform economy, the interest of the political administration into the phenomenon has been mainly emerging through the disruptive impact of some of the platforms that have generated in the big city, like the case of Uber and the conflict with the taxi driver, or the case of Airbnb and the possible problematics about gentrification. It has emerged as a conflictual an ambit of different perspectives. So this is how come most of the cities has getting to doing something around it. The main general trends about policy administration in this ambit is one is that there is a regulatory vacuum in the an uncertainty in the sense of it's unclear which is the regulation that has applied to these platforms, or it was the debate about it should be considered digital economy, and so, for example, e-commerce regulation at the European level, or they have applied for example, Uber is only a company of provide information, or Uber is a taxi driving and mobility case, and so it should be applied the regulation of the mobility case, or in the case of Airbnb, the tourist regulation. No, this is the kind of over time it has become more into the sectorial regulation should apply to the digital platforms. It has become a top priority. And there is, we are in the moment of making regulatory efforts. Last year, the European Commission provided the European Agenda of Collaborative Economy. The national states are also, which has the dimension which is more slow into getting into the, is more proactive is at the European level or at the city level. And the cities, because they are the ones who are concentrated more the activity and also concentrated the impact. We have been moving from a very narrow regulatory framework of clarifying which regulation apply into a much more broader public policy approach, referring to not only looking into the challenges that this disruptive impact might provide, but also looking into the opportunities that might involve for example, for political growth, for economical growth, or for public innovation in terms of how to perform the policy themselves. There has been also a move of the agenda into previously the general directives of technological or digital policies were the one who were dealing with this phenomenon, and now it's more it came to me the language of the European Commission, the DG growth in European terms, the general directive of economical developments. So now, previously this was like an ambit of the regulation of the internet, and now it has become in the ambit, and he's been a leader in the inside of the administration by the economical type of positions. And but there is a very there is a challenge of the collaborative platform economy into the political structure themselves, because it has it's very transversal. It's very it can apply to tourism. It can apply to economical development. It can apply to social inclusion. And the tendency is to make like interdisciplinary kind of interdepartmental kind of actors as part of the administration in order to see what to do. It has emerged also the framework of sharing cities, as the cities who want to characterize themselves as being sharing, the first one who present themselves as a sharing city was Seoul, which is actually the city who has made more investment into becoming a sharing city, referring to promoting the growing of these activities in the economical sector or the civil society, but also in terms of how the administration is being performed and how can incorporate more collaborative dynamics in the way of providing, of doing the political, the defining the policies. There has been also a process of confluence between the cities. The first one, Sharing City Summit, the first one happened in Amsterdam in 2016 with 12 cities coming together. The cities that are more proactive in this ambit is Amsterdam, Seoul, New York, Milan, Barcelona. Then it was last year, no, the year before was in New York, and last year was in Barcelona. I will present it more in detail later. Now we are seeing also the emergence of national-based sharing city programs, like the case of Sharing City Sweden, which is a national program by the national government of Sweden, which is helping the sharing cities to make an exchange and support each other. We did a survey to to 20 cities, but here we have data for 17, 20 cities around the world about which are actually their policies in the ambit of platform economy. And this is the ambit that for them is more focused. The promotion of innovation is the ambit that is more present into the policies of the cities. Then it comes social inclusion in the sense of how far platform economy can provide a way of including more not generally socially excluded parts of the population, economical development, the regulation of disruptive impact of the platforms, the improving of the environment, because there is a lot of expectation that the platform economy might help to reduce the consumption of materials and might facilitate the circularity of economy. And lately, the actions referring to the consumer protection type of interventions. Here you see that there are in different colors is because we have identified that actually the big cities, the cities which involve New York or New York, Barcelona or Paris, the main purpose and the ambit in which they have developed more policies is in the ambit of disruptive impact. In contrast, the cities that are medium sized or are smaller, they are more focused into social inclusion and improving the environment. So the impact of the platform economy and the type of public administration reaction is different depending on the site actually of the city and the historical goal of the city. But if previously until now I have been talking about what public administration has done in terms of how to embrace the challenges and opportunities of the platform economy. But actually, what if we can differentiate the different models of platform economy on the basis of how they perform on the start of qualities that I was presenting previously, like what differentiate an open commons modality like Wikipedia from a unicorn modality like Airbnb? They are not only different from the perspective of the dimensions that I have present, but they are also different about how they inject with the public administration and which type of political system they support in their actions, no? And here again, we can differentiate in putting into the stream. Here I am making a very big simplification, but putting into the stream, we can define like two approaches. On the one hand, we would have in one stream the unicorn model of what Uber and Airbnb are actually injecting with the administration and which discourse we have in contraposition to an horizon of open or commons modality of collaborative policy making while incorporating dimensions of collaboration into the policy making. So in this stream we have the framework of what is known the self-regulation. So basically the argument of Uber is that this ambit should not, the role of the administration should be very limited, because actually we are in a better position to regulate this ambit because we have the data. So traditionally the state has the data of the sensor. So the element of having the knowledge and the data about ambits was a resource for the public administrations to establish the regulation. Now the data is in the platforms, and the platforms doesn't want to provide the data to the public administration. So this is one of the arguments, that self-regulation, the platforms are in a better position because they have more access, more knowledge about how the activity is being performed. So they do a double disempowering, if we want, from my perspective, of the communities, because they don't involve the of the platform, but also of the administration by not providing the data to the administration about how they are performing. No, and it's extremely problematic from an administration perspective. Airbnb doesn't provide the data about how many houses are being rented. It's very difficult to actually make the planification of housing policies, or to get to know, like in a hotel, you make us like this, and you more or less know how many rooms are. In Airbnb, you cannot know if Airbnb doesn't provide you. So this is the big fight between the cities and the platforms around getting to know the data. And actually, cities are collaborating to lobby the European Commission for making sure the European Commission forced the platform to provide the data. That's the first one. Second is the element of lobby effort by these platforms, the revolving doors and the corruption. And revolving doors, I am referring to put very concrete cases. The main representative, the commissioner of the European Commission dealing with the digital agenda after leaving his place, establishing the base for the European agenda of collaborative economy, she went to work to Uber, or the president of the European Commission, Barroso, went to work for Goldman Sachs, which is one of the main funders of Uber. No, so it's here also at the Spanish state we can see representatives from political parties, members of political parties, ex-members of political parties with political responsibilities going to work into this company. So it's an activity that is happening. There is also the element of glass ceiling of through the regulation limiting the possibility of growing of other models. In contraposition, and here again I am doing like a very stream, we have the possibility, the injecting into collaborative policies for collaborative economy in the sense of co-creating the policies involving a wiki way or a collaborative way involving all the sectors, what is known the quadruple helix, involving all the sectors in the ambit, not only the platforms because they have the data, but involving the public administration, the third sector, the economical sector, and the university in order to define in a co-creative manner the policies. We have the possibility of communification in the sense of an alternative to privatization. Through the privatization process, we have seen the externalization of some of the public services into private companies. Here we could have the possible partnership between public administration and commons modality or collaborative modalities of platform economy in order to provide public services. There is also, again, a move into a collaborative public services, for example, the what is known a mobility as a service, like integrating metro with train, with the possibility of sharing car all together as part of a public policy to assure that all the ambits in a city provide the possibility or support the needs of mobility into the city. I will refer particularly to the case again of Barcelona and the Barcelona Collaborative Economy Plan, because it's an ambit in which we have made partnership between the Open University of Catalonia, which Dimons is part, and the City Council of Barcelona. The key approaches of Barcelona in this field, which is one of the cities that is being more proactive into the policies in the field, is one, try to make collaborative the policies of the platform economy, and second, that the platform economy, the model that might be more beneficial for the city or aligned with the interests is the open commons model or the platform cooperativism. In terms of how to make the collaborative the policies has been developed through these last 4 years, mainly by organizing Barcola, which means Barcelona Colabora. It's a working group between the city council and 40 representatives of the sector in the city. Okay. This working group then it had been through organization of forums with 400 people coming, for example, which end up with policy recommendations that has been incorporating into the policies being applied. Also the use of the CD in Barcelona, which is a digital platform for which any citizen can go and say, I support more this policy in contraposition to this other one. And the last thing that was incorporated is a internal group that is interdisciplinary, interdepartmental for coordinating internally in the city council. This is the members of Barcola, which follow this element of the quadruple elite, being the public administration, the platform, and the economical actors, support organizations and universities, as all the actors like trying to define which might be the best policies. This is the result of the ProCommons event, which 100 people inject and end up with the policy recommendations that the administration, that 80% of them has been applying these last 4 years. These are specific measures that has been developed, organizing meetings for helping the ambit to get to know, providing feedback, funding by match funding, referring to giving funding by the city council through a crowdfunding platform, reuse and circular economy of project in order to reutilize the computers that are being any more used at the administration to be provided to civil society, incorporate Wi-Fi net into the system of access to wireless into the city. So there has been a lot of experimentation, which is very characteristic in this field. Last year was organized the Sharing City Summit in Barcelona with 50 cities representing from all the continents, cities from all the continents, but I would stress the element that they were from all kind of governments, like also progressive governments, liberal governments, even you can say neoliberal governments. They all came together and they share some common views, even if the diversity. And they end up with a common agreement. It was developed in the framework of the Smart City Congress, which is the worldwide congress, more important worldwide congress on technology and the city. It was a part of a city encounter with the city representatives. It was a vice-mayor level, so it was a very high political level involvement of the cities, because as I say, this ambit has become a top priority. There was based also on the confluence between institutions. It was the city council organizing, but also with work, a knowledge institution coming together and through our research. And actually, we published this book with the research that we did about the policies being applied by the cities in order to inform the meeting and also the final declaration that result. But to not have a policy, administrative-centric view about public policies, it was organized also co-creation sessions with other actors, not only public administration. The meeting ended up with a common declaration about cities' principles and commitments for the platform economy that were signed by the cities and presented. Here are the main principles referring to the necessity to differentiate between platforms, the respect of the labor rights, and the necessity to adapt labor regulations, but respecting the rights, the importance of inclusion, the providing public protection, the save the environment, like have an environmental perspective, the respect of the civic citizens' digital rights and the digital sovereignty in the field, the city sovereignty themselves, in the sense of this is what I was more surprised about, how all different kind of governments with different political views share this vision that there are certain economical conglomerates of platforms like Uber or Airbnb that have too much power in front of an administration that cannot make respect the public, the local regulation. So the necessity to collaborate between the cities to negotiate together, in the sense of if Barcelona go alone to negotiate with Airbnb, it's not the same if it comes with 30 cities, no? So this is in the direction of the actions of collaboration between the cities, the importance also of the economical promotion and the possibility of, here we have the possibility of scalability of the social economy and the democratization of the economy through the more collaborative and the models that have a more democratic quality, and also the looking for the general interest into the development of the field. Finally, to invite you to the next Sharing Cities encounter that will be also will happen also this year, which involves also researchers, and it's extremely in a context of fake news, and particularly in this field, is extremely important the evidence and research results for informing the policies. And the next encounter is going to be this November, also again in Barcelona. So thank you very much.